background, black, white, brown, oriental, if you keep God's law,
and what law is this?
Exactly. To love God with all your heart, your mind, and your strength, and love your neighbour as yourself.
That's enough.
That is enough.
And the dietary laws?
That God does not actually mind whether we eat pork or not. That's the bombshell.
So why do you keep worrying about my Muslims? Don't worry about Muslims.
Okay.
This is a bombshell for you, because your disciples of Jesus didn't say what you just said. So do you know more about the teachings of Jesus than the disciples? Because they didn't say what you just said.
Okay, fair enough.
So do you have more authority?
You said, what is my understanding according to
the Bible? No, I'm asking you a simple question. Do you have more authority to know the teachings of Jesus than the disciples?
I have no authority whatsoever. I'm just an ordinary person.
So in your scripture, you've just said to me, what you eat, it doesn't matter, yeah? Jesus disagrees with you in your scripture.
No, I don't think he does.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you accept that the teachings of the disciples reflect the teachings of Jesus?
Are you talking about the Synod of Jerusalem?
No, I'm saying to you, do you accept the teachings of the disciples of Jesus are a reflection of what Jesus taught?
Yes.
Right. So if the disciples of Jesus taught all the food laws do matter, yeah, then what you just said is wrong.
Yes, but I don't think that they did.
Why don't you think they did?
Because of the writings of the apostles.
So how do you understand Acts 15?
Acts 15.
Council of Jerusalem.
Yes, that was because it was. This is their exact point. You had people from a non-religious background coming into a religious situation.
Right.
You had a lot of religious people who didn't eat pork because it's bad to eat pork. They were circumcised according to the Muslim law. They kept the offerings. They went to the temple five times a day and did the morning sacrifice, blah, blah, blah.
Yep.
Then you had these Gentiles who'd been worshipping idols and didn't have a clue. Right?
Right.
Now, a bit like you and me coming from don't have a clue as to what to do. What the Synod at Jerusalem said was, don't trouble them with all these laws. But obviously, they've got to keep themselves from fornication. They mustn't eat things strangled.
So why can't they eat things strangled?
Because it would defile their conscience.
So that would mean all food is not clean?
According to their conscience.
No, that would mean food is not clean. Because they can't eat it.
Yeah, all right. Then you shouldn't eat meat.
Right. Well, Paul says you eat without fear of conscience.
Because the key is man's conscience and God. Now, you're going to get people from, say, China who've been eating snakes, dogs. Who knows what they've been eating? But if they show love to their neighbour and they show love to God on the day of judgment, God's not going to say, well, you didn't keep the dietary laws. Off you go to hell because you ate a snake or you ate a pig. God isn't like that. Now, I agree it is good to not eat pork. I know what pigs are. I actually keep pigs.
I haven't mentioned
and
pork.
It's good not to eat pork.
I haven't mentioned pork.
It's probably good to be circumcised. I've not had the opportunity to be circumcised.
You don't need to be circumcised.
And it's probably good to pray five times a day. I actually pray three times a day. But God is not going to hold us to it.
Okay.
Because God loves all the people of the world. He loves Muslims.
Is God going to hold
you? Happy when Muslims keep.
Is God going to hold you to the teachings of Jesus?
Yes.
Yes.
The teachings of Jesus is that we love God with all our heart and love our neighbour.
Okay. Is God going to hold you to the teachings of Jesus?
Yes.
Right. And if you don't do the teachings of Jesus, then what? As a Christian.
It's about knowing God.
No, as a Christian, if you don't follow the teachings of Jesus,
yes.
Well, then what?
You get punished.
How?
God will punish you.
What, in hell?
No, he'll punish you here and now.
Oh, punish you here and now?
Yes.
So if you don't follow the teachings of Jesus here and now, God will punish you here and now. And in the hereafter?
You need to repent.
And if you don't?
Well, God forgives.
If you don't repent?
If you don't repent, then you're unrepentant, you go to hell.
So as a Christian,
yes.
You believe that if you die without repenting, you go to hell?
Yes.
You believe that? Do you believe that? As a Christian, if you die without repenting, you go to hell?
Well, if you don't repent,
Yeah. Fantastic. Paul doesn't preach that. Anyway.
Paul does preach that.
No, he doesn't. About repentance.
Where are you talking about?
Okay. Basically, Christianity teaches, as a Christian,
yes.
All you need to do for salvation is to believe Jesus died for your sins.
No, not at all.
Really?
Paul never taught that.
Really?
That is a Protestant distortion.
All right.
It's a misconception.
Okay.
And it's not what Jesus taught or Paul taught.
If that was true, you could just go kill someone whenever you wanted.
Well, Christians believe they can.
No, well, Well, they're wrong.
That's wrong. That's 100% wrong.
I'm glad you said that. That's good. It's good you said that. That's honesty I like. Most Christians, you speak to Jay Smith now, he thinks he's going to heaven regardless of what he does.
No.
Because Jesus died for him. That's what they believe.
No, here we are.
And see, they believe by Paul when he says, it's not by your works you shall be judged, but by your faith. But faith in what?
Please, here, let me read it. This is backing up what you're saying. And I saw the dead, both great and small, stand before God. And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged of those things which were written in the books according.
But you're not quoting we're not quoting a dream.
No, this is the scripture.
It's a dream. Yeah, well, all right.
We as Christians believe the scripture, and the scripture says we'll be judged according to our deeds, not whether we believe.
Going to go off topic a little bit now. Why do you believe this scripture?
Because it's God's.
Because what?
Because it's God's revelation to me.
Why do you believe that's God's revelation?
In this, the apostles were inspired by the Holy Spirit.
How do you know that?
God gave them the words. It has to be an element of faith. If you believe the Quran or you believe
the
Bible,
with
there has to be an element
of faith. Right. So what you're saying is, you have faith, it's from God then. Your hope is from God.
There are mistakes in this.
You accept that?
I accept there are mistakes.
Do you accept that?
Other than that, I need to go and check
it. All right, go ahead.
But all that God has to say to me, as a white Englishman from an atheist background living in 2016, in order for me to be forgiven, he's written it in here. Because God doesn't make mistakes. So even though in this book, and possibly in the Quran too, there may be mistakes, God himself...
No, there's no mistakes in the Quran.
Well, it says in the Quran that you can believe the Injil.
What's the Injil?
Exactly.
Now, what do you think the Injil is?
So, where is it then?
No, what do you think it is?
Well, obviously, you think it's the...
No, what do you think it is? What do you think it is?
I believe that... I don't know what the Injil is.
Well, you put that forward as if it was that.
All right. You say it's the teachings of Jesus.
No, you just assume that I believe the teachings
of Jesus. Injil is a Muslim concept. It's not a Christian concept.
Really? Have you read your Bible?
I do read my Bible.
Wasn't Jesus teaching the Evangelion in Galilee?
Yes, he was.
Okay, what's the Evangelion?
We've got the Evangels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John.
No. Jesus wasn't preaching the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John.
No.
Right.
Yeah.
Jesus
but
was preaching. No. Jesus wasn't preaching that.
No.
Or the letters of Paul.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. We believe the Injil is what Jesus was preaching. It's simple. Yeah? This is your Matthew, Mark.
So where do you read it? If you're told to read it, where are you going to read it?
I don't need to read it.
But the Quran tells you to read it.
It doesn't.
It does. I'm sure it says that in one of the surahs that you should read the Injil.
No.
And you should believe it.
No.
And you should believe. You read the Torah.
No. The only reason it speaks
so
about.
Where is the Torah?
The only reason it speaks about the Injil.
To believe in the books.
Yeah, we believe in the books, the previous revelation. We believe in revelation, obviously, in scripture.
So where is it?
As it was at the time.
But you're saying that God's made a mistake. Because if God.
I haven't said God made a mistake.
If Allah told you to read the Injil, and the Injil
where does Allah
exist,
tell me to read the Injil?
How can you read it?
Where does he tell me to read the Injil?
I don't know, I haven't read the Quran.
Well, you just quoted that it did say it.
But that's what I heard.
Don't believe everything you hear. Don't believe everything you hear, mate.
But it's true for a fact that it does.
There are some people here who think we evolved from fish, mate, yeah? Don't believe everything you hear, yeah?
Okay. Well, I've forgotten the original point.
The original point.
I thought that you were to read the Torah.
No.
And read the Injil.
No.
And believe
I'll make it easy for you. The Quran is what we call the Muhaymin. Yeah? And the Muhaymin is the watcher book. Right? So what it does, it will highlight where you've corrupted your books and the Jews corrupted their books.
No, let's just back up. Who am I?
Christian.
I'm just an English
Christian.
White person.
You believe whoever.
In England, and I've had my life changed through reading a book.
Okay.
There might have some mistakes.
Okay.
But I didn't corrupt.
Well, I'm a white man living in England who's embraced Islam for reading a book that has no mistakes in it.
But our background is the same.
Yes.
We had no hope. We had no belief in eternity. We had no hope for eternity.
So I'm asking a simple question.
You've got hope.
Why are you trusting that book?
I've got hope for eternity.
Why are you trusting that book?
Do you see the difference? Now, we believe in a God who cares about people like you and me,
Alhamdulillah,
who are atheists, who've got no hope in the world.
I wasn't without hope. I didn't care. But go on.
Yeah, but you believe in a God who cares about you.
Alhamdulillah.
Yeah. And I believe in a God who cares about me.
Right.
Now, you've been directed in one way. I've been directed in another way. Do you now have hope of eternal life?
Inshallah.
I have hope of eternal
life. Everyone's got eternal life.
Well, talk to some of these atheists who haven't given up on their atheism, or some of the Christians who've become atheists. They don't have a hope.
No, no. But eternal life, whether it's in hellfire or paradise, is a difference.
Do you see what I mean?
Atheists so believe in energy, don't they? They believe we're all energy. Everything exists in the universe. So when we die, we all go back to the universe. Yeah. They believe in eternal life. They just can't explain it. They've got no explanation for it.
Well,
forget
I
that.
Was just talking to an atheist now who said he didn't believe in eternal
life. These atheists changed their minds. I'm talking about this. I want to know why this you believe is reliable.
Because it changed my life.
Okay. How did that change? What did you read in that changed your life? Apart from God saying he loves you.
He forgave my sins.
Alhamdulillah.
I, as an atheist, right, living in an atheist town with atheist parents, was told not to worry about guilt.
I understand that. I'm talking about...
But I couldn't deal with this guilt problem.
Okay.
But when I read this, and that this man Jesus could forgive...
How do you know what's the mistake and what isn't a mistake?
Because my life changed. I felt peace.
No. In that book
what
now...
What I can say is that I felt
in
peace.
In that book, how do you know what's a mistake and what isn't a mistake? For example, Paul on the road to Damascus. Just had it with my man here. Yeah? And I use the food dietary law thing as an example.
Yeah?
Paul was teaching something different to the disciples. Yeah? Now, you might think it's just dietary law and food law and it doesn't really matter. Love God all your heart and all that. Yeah? It matters profusely. Reason why? Whatever was revealing to Paul, was contrary to what the disciples were teaching. And when the disciples...
I disagree.
I'll tell you why. Well, tell how bad it got for Paul that he was told to come and repent for preaching that.
Sorry, say that bit again.
Paul was told to repent for teaching that.
Oh, you mean in Acts 15?
Acts 21.
Can you show me?
You're the man with the Bible in your hand. And Paul was told to repent and go and make burnt offering for that.
No, I don't think it was because he sinned.
No. Read it. It's clear.
Or it might be for his sins. Not because he taught things
clear
to the apostles.
Clear. And they didn't know half the things he was writing about them.
Right, we have four men which have a vow on...
No, I'll read it for you.
Yeah?
You're reading the wrong part. I don't know...
Verse 25.
Yeah, I don't know why you've let's read before, yeah? Not your highlight, underlining. All right, still right.
There are no verses.
Oh, this is a flipping strange... What kind of flipping Bible is this?
Tyndale.
All right.
It's 100 years before King James.
Flipping it. On the morrow... flipping it. Went in with us unto James, and all the seniors came together. And when he had saluted them, he told by order what things God had wrought amongst the Gentiles by his misdirection. When they heard it, they glorified the Lord and said unto him, Thou sayest, brother, how many thousands of Jews which believe, and they're all zealous over the law, they are informed of that thou teachest all the Jews which are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses, and sayest that thou ought not to circumcise their children, neither to live after the customs.
Yes.
What it is therefore, the
most of the Gentiles.
One second.
Not to the
what
Jews.
It is therefore, the multitude must needs come together, for they shall hear that thou art come. Do therefore, this is what we say to you. We have men here who have a vow on them, meaning they have to go and repent.
Yeah.
Okay, the Nazarite vow. And take a purify yourself with them. And do custom them that they may shave their heads, and all shall know the things that which they have heard of are nothing. Meaning
that doesn't mean he repented.
No,
He was keeping the law.
First thing, the disciples are saying to Paul here, we've heard you've done this, and the people think you've done this, but to show you haven't done this, then you need to do this. Right. So meaning you don't believe these things.
No, that's I'd have to differ with
all right,
you.
Alright, okay.
I think what they're saying
but,
is that...
But thou, thy, no, look, that they shall know the things which they have heard are of nothing, and that thou yourself keep the law.
Yes, that was the key thing.
As we have taught the Gentiles and concluded, they observe no such things, but they keep themselves from things offered to idols, from blood, and from strangled, and from fornication.
Yes.
Then the next day, Paul took the men and purified himself with them, and entered the temple, declaring the fulfilling the days of purification, until that an oblation should be offered for every one of them.
Yes.
So here's the story. I mean, this English is English is
my narrative.
Okay, this English is madness. But anyway,
as that's the original.
Right, right. We know Paul.
15:20 okay. English.
We know what Paul's been preaching. You don't have to keep the law. We know this.
To the Gentiles.
Yeah, he's preaching. Eat what you like in the meat market without fear of conscience. Yeah, we know he's preaching this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the disciples said, "We've heard this, and the people know you've come here, mm-hmm. but to show you don't believe that yourself." Yeah,
okay.
and to show that you do keep the law,
right?
You need to purify yourself.
Yes.
Make burnt offering.
Yes.
As your repentance, which is the only point of burnt offering.
Well, it doesn't say that.
Well, the Nazarite vow is for repentance. If you make the Nazarite vow, it's for repentance. Making a burnt offering is for repentance.
I don't know that it was necessary.
Okay, I'll give you the. You can give your own narrative.
Yeah,
okay. Because we have told the Gentiles.
Yeah.
They abstain from blood.
I see your point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We told the Gentiles they abstain from blood.
Yeah.
They don't eat blood of a strangled animal,
yes.
nor any animal sacrificed to an idol.
Yes.
So we've basically told
that's
the
Acts 15.
No,
that's what they
that's told Acts 15. That Acts 15 is the Council of Jerusalem.
Yeah, but that's what they told the Gentiles.
Acts 15 is the Council of Jerusalem when it was decreed.
Yeah.
This is a reminder of the decree.
Yes, I agree.
Yeah.
Yes.
This is showing them we've already told them this.
Yeah.
So you're telling them something else.
Right. Okay.
Now. This is how my whole conversation started here.
Yes, no, yeah,
you as a Christian
sense.
Today
yeah.
are going against the teachings of the disciples. Because you're not doing what they decreed.
I see your point.
Good.
But I disagree.
Good.
Because what was disturbing the Jews in Jerusalem was that he was undermining the Mosaic law. That's what they couldn't handle as Jews. They were keeping the Mosaic law and they were following Jesus too. And they thought, we as Jews, following Jesus as a Jew.
What did they decree for Gentiles?
Must also follow
what
the law.
You've missed the point. What did the disciples decree for Gentiles?
Just that they keep themselves from strangled.
Right.
That they they don't fornicate.
Right.
That they keep themselves from blood.
Right.
Not to eat blood.
What does that mean? What does that mean? Not eat blood.
There mustn't be blood in the meat.
Oh, how do you stop blood being in the meat?
Well, you drain it off.
Halal or kosher, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
And you what's the last one? And you don't worship idols. You don't.
No, you don't eat animals sacrificed
animals
to idols.
To idols.
What was Paul teaching about that?
Oh, right. Now, Paul said, if you take anything from the shambles, eat it without conscience,
right.
without worry.
Now
but, he goes on to say, but if your conscience troubles you, don't eat
right,
it.
Right, right. So, Paul's saying...
Which he's saying, from God's perspective, God actually doesn't mind.
I agree. So, Paul's saying, eat from the marketplace, whatever you like, but if it troubles you, don't eat it. The disciples are decreeing, don't eat it.
Yes.
So, Paul's saying, make a choice.
Yes.
And the disciples are saying, don't eat it.
Yes.
All right. Can you not see the contradiction?
No, it's not, because one is in a Gentile context, where it's all Greeks getting saved. The other's in a Jewish context, where Jews are getting saved.
One man is saying, don't worry about what you eat, and the disciples are saying, worry about what you eat. Right? And you're saying there's no contradiction.
Because of the background.
No. One man is saying, don't worry about what you eat, and the disciples of Jesus are saying, worry about what you eat. You say there's no contradiction.
No, I agree, there's a contradiction.
A huge contradiction. All right, now here's the sad thing. Christians today are still not following the disciples of Jesus. They're following Paul's teachings.
I would disagree.
Okay, are you a Christian?
Yes, sir.
Do you eat the blood of an animal?
No.
You eat halal?
If we slaughter a pig...
Do you eat halal?
No, I don't eat halal.
Right. Do you eat McDonald's? Burger?
No, Big Mac? No, I eat fillets of fish.
Do you eat meat from...
eat pork.
Forget pork. Pork's irrelevant.
But when we kill the pig, we
forget
drain the blood off.
Forget the pig. No, forget the pig. Remember the pig. Do you, when you eat a chicken, is it a halal chicken?
No, it's just what I buy from the shambles.
So it's not a chicken.
I do what Paul says.
This is exactly my point.
Yeah.
Why do you do what Paul says and not what the disciples say?
Because Paul defines what it means to be a Christian.
And the disciples don't.
They were in a Jewish context. Paul was apostle to the Gentiles.
No.
And I'm a Gentile.
No. First thing, this decree by the disciples of Jesus,
I keep
who we've just said.
But I keep them.
No, we just, no.
I don't think eating no. to idols. I don't.
You eat blood?
No, I don't eat blood.
Yes, you do.
Not.
Yes, you do. Yes, you do. Do you eat halal chicken? Do you eat kosher chicken?
Yeah, I do eat the halal chicken, but I,
you know,
I know. When I get to the day of judgment, God is not going to say, "Do you realize that chicken you ate in?"
No, here's the problem. Here's the problem. I'll tell you the problem.
God is what?
I'll tell you what problem is now. Yeah. See, we've exposed.
That is a problem.
No.
We're exposing your God.
No. I'll tell you what we've exposed. Okay, we've exposed that Paul is teaching something different to the disciples on this issue empirically. So now we have a problem.
Yeah, you've got a narrative which is it's a problem.
No,
I accept.
I'll explain why it's a problem.
But it isn't a problem.
I'll explain why it's a problem.
You explain why it's a problem.
Oh, okay. Because once you do that, and once you trust Paul,
yeah,
then you listen to everything else he says. Now, if you look at the teachings of Christianity, Jesus didn't teach them. Original sin is not a teaching of Jesus.
Hang on. You just made two things there. You talked about the teachings of Paul and the teachings of Christianity. I agree the teachings of Christianity are not the teachings of Jesus. I disagree that the teachings of Paul are not the teachings of Jesus. Paul taught the same as Jesus. Christianity doesn't teach the same as Jesus.
I've just shown you.
Don't confuse Paul's teachings with Christianity.
Did Paul teach the same about Jesus when it comes to food? No. No, he didn't.
Jesus was in a Jewish context.
What are you talking about?
I'm talking about Jews who got saved, who believe, follow Jesus, still had to keep the law.
No, the decree by the disciples were for Gentile Christians.
No, but those weren't Mosaic.
Gentiles.
Those four things.
They were Gentile. Are you a Gentile?
Yes.
Are you a Gentile?
Yes.
So the disciples have told you what you can eat and what you can't eat.
Yes.
And you ignore them.
No, I don't.
You do.
I don't eat
Which means you ignore Jesus.
No, I don't eat blood.
You eat blood.
No, I come from Lancashire.
You eat blood.
In Lancashire, we eat black pudding, all right?
Yeah.
Black pudding is made from the blood of a pig.
Yeah, I know.
I will not eat black pudding. Okay? There's other things that have blood in them. I do not eat them.
Listen, if you're
kill a pig, food, we drain the blood.
If your food,
I know to you it's disgusting to eat a pig, but we will drain
the blood.
If your food,
if your chicken or your beef or your lamb is not halal or it's not kosher, then you're eating the blood, mate.
But God is not going to send me to hell because of that. Is he? Come on. He's not.
Do you understand?
God is not going to send me to hell.
Don't you you're missing. You're not doing what Jesus said.
But
you just said,
but
if you
are
don't
you doing what Jesus said?
To me.
Jesus said, love your enemies. Jesus said, do unto others.
Jesus isn't my prophet.
As you would have them do.
Jesus isn't my prophet.
But you say you're the true followers of Jesus.
No, I'm a true follower of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi
wasallam. Yeah, but you also say the Muslims are the true followers of Jesus. You told me that once.
Listen, very, very simple how it works. Up until Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Jesus is the last prophet.
I thought you said he's just a prophet to the Jews.
Who?
You guys, you say that Jesus came for the Jews only.
I believe
not
that.
But for the lost sheep.
Yeah, I believe that. That's what he said, innit?
Yeah, but you don't understand what he meant by that.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, didn't he call the Gentiles dogs? Didn't he call you a dog?
Yes.
All right. So he called you a dog?
Yeah. And by nature, I am a dog.
And the children are...
But in God's eyes, I am a child of Israel.
You are a human being.
So Jesus was kind of a racist in your New Testament.
Why is that so funny?
Do you accept yourself that you're a dog? Jesus put you as a
sinner. You know what the Ahithophel said to David when the King David, he fell before, he said, who am I that you should look upon such a dead dog as I am?
Right.
And when I came to God, those were my words. Who am I that you should look upon such a dead dog as I am?
Okay. Do you know in John 4:1? You know,
and now I'm not a dog.
Do you know what?
I am a child of God.
Yeah. Do you know what it says in John? You know what it says in John 1:4, isn't it?
And the same can happen to
you know what it says in John 1:4, isn't it?
Any human being.
What does it say in John 1:4? The beloved believeth not every spirit, but rather he tests them, for the many false prophets sent out to the world.
And the spirit that came to me at that time.
How shall you know them?
God's spirit.
How shall you know them?
Because he brings
how
peace.
Shall you know them? No. By their
peace.
Fruits you shall know them.
Peace.
By their fruits.
And the fruit of the spirit is love, joy, and peace.
Let's understand. No. What are the fruits of Paul?
I came to Jesus.
Look.
He gave me love, joy, and peace.
Look. John 1:4 warns of false prophets and false teachers, right? And
who turn people back to the law.
Right. No.
Yes. False. That's what Paul says in Galatians.
Well, quote Galatians. I'm quoting in John.
Okay. All right.
Yeah? Where John says, beloved, believe in every spirit, but yes. This is Jesus' words,
yes.
Beloved, believe in every spirit, but rather he tests them, for the many false prophets sent out into the world.
I agree.
And how shall we know them? By the fruits you shall know them.
Exactly.
Okay. So Paul comes along now claiming to be a prophet.
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
And we test him.
Apostle, actually.
And we test him. And his fruits are, he's not doing what Jesus said.
No.
And I'll tell you how it gets worse for you, because if you read your book, you like Revelations.
Yeah.
What does it say about Balaam? What it was Balaam. About someone amongst you doing what Balaam
yes,
did.
Yes, yeah, that's it. Who's, one of the churches.
Who was Balaam?
Balaam was the prophet who was called to bring a curse upon Israel by King Balak.
And what happened to him?
He refused to bring a curse upon him.
So what happened
to
him?
How beautiful are thy tents?
What happened to him?
He continued to rebel against God.
He was shown a false prophet?
Yes.
And he preached what? Eat what you like in the meat markets. Eat food sacrificed to idols. Forget the dietary laws. Yes, he did. So now in Revelations we have a warning of someone amongst you who is doing what Balaam did. So now you tell me in the community who was doing what Balaam did. Who amongst the Christians, the disciples or whomever, was teaching you could go against the law of the food laws? Only one man. Paul.
But you know why?
By their fruits you shall know them.
But I can tell you why it was only one man.
Why?
Because he was preaching to the Gentiles. He was the apostle to the Gentiles.
No, he was a self-appointed. He was the self-appointed apostle.
He gave hope.
Who calls him an apostle? Who called him an apostle? Other than himself.
Peter does.
No?
He does. No, he said, who am also an apostle.
And don't quote through Peter, because that wasn't written by Peter.
He says, but he speaks of Paul. Peter quotes Paul. He says, he spoke of many things which are hard to understand.
Read it. And I'll repeat myself. If you quote 2 Peter, it's not written by Peter.
What kind of Bible is that?
It's madness.
No, what's the name of the Bible?
Tyndale.
William Tyndale.
He was
the one, he died for translating this.
Right.
He was chased all the way across Europe. They eventually caught him and burned him at the stake because of this book. And Bishop of London got as many of these books together as he could and burnt them in front of St. Paul's Cathedral. That tells you something about the established church.
How many books are on it?
Wait, don't allow him to deflect.
This is just the New Testament.
Don't allow him to deflect.
Find that
piece. Keep him on point.
Yeah. Here we are. And suppose that the long-suffering the Lord is health, even as our dearly beloved brother Paul. So Peter calls him.
Where's it written though?
A beloved brother Paul.
Where's it written?
It's in 2 Peter.
All right, what did I say to you?
According to the wisdom given
to him. What did I say to you about 2 Peter?
Wrote to you.
What did I just say to you about 2 Peter? It's not written by Peter.
Well, who wrote? You tell me.
It's anonymous. We don't know. It wasn't Peter.
All right.
Because he speaks about the destruction of the temple, which happened after Peter died.
All right. Well, whoever it was,
I believe
it's part of the.
So it's not Peter.
But he says that Paul.
But it's not Peter,
though.
But you just said Peter.
He doesn't say he's a false prophet.
Well, it's not Peter, is it?
But you're saying he's a false prophet.
It's a forgery.
It's certainly not.
Of course, it's a forgery.
All right. Well, I could say your Quran's a forgery.
Really? How could you say it's a forgery?
You hold to the Quran.
How can you say it's a forgery?
You sincerely
hold to the Quran. How can you say Quran's a forgery?
I can't say that.
You just said it was.
You can't say that this is a forgery.
It is a forgery.
But you can't say
I'll tell you why I'm saying it. Because Peter didn't write that and it's claiming he did. So it's a forgery.
Okay. The people who
it's unanimous amongst Christian scholars that Peter didn't write 2 Peter.
Okay. Well, Erasmus mistakenly called it 2 Peter. That doesn't mean it's
all right.
Not canonical.
If it's mistaken by he could have been mistakenly done anything yet.
Doesn't
but Peter
mean it's a
so I'll repeat my question. Who called Paul an apostle? It wasn't Peter because Peter didn't write that.
No, but it was one of the apostles who wrote to the churches at that time.
No.
And it's part of the canon of Scripture, isn't it?
It's only part of the canon of Scripture because in Council of Nicaea they decided, we'll put that in.
Well, it was Erasmus, actually. Erasmus put this together, and then Tyndale translated it into English. I'll tell you which version it is.
It's in all the... Listen, that lie is in all the Bibles.
It's not a lie.
2 Peter. It is.
It's not a lie.
It's called 2 Peter, but it wasn't written by Peter.
Yeah, but that's... Okay.
How can you call something 2 Peter if Peter wrote it?
That doesn't mean it's a forgery. It doesn't mean it's not God's word. It just means it was given the wrong
name. It means Peter wasn't written. Peter didn't write it.
Well, some people say Paul wrote Hebrews. Some people say Paul didn't write Hebrews.
The majority of Bible scholars say he didn't.
Because he came from God. It's a message.
How do you know it came
from
God? How do you know?
Because you can tell he's self-authenticating.
How is
God's
that?
God's word. Because there's something within your soul responds to God's truth. Jesus said...
Are you Muslim?
For this end I came into
the Muslim?
World, and to this end I was born, to give testimony to the
truth. Muslim?
Those that are of the truth will hear me. And all of those...
So here's your problem. Let me explain your problem.
...will hear the truth.
Let me explain your problem.
And you will believe it.
Yeah. Let me explain your problem. You keep quoting
from... even be you,
you keep quoting from this book. As if it means something.
It means a lot to me.
No, I know it does.
There you are.
I know you've had this...
Erasmus. He did four different versions, okay? Of the Greek. He compiled the Greek manuscripts in four different versions.
Okay.
He did 1516, 1519, which is the one that Luther used, which doesn't have John chapter 5, verse 2 in it.
Which manuscripts did he use?
That's 1519. So Luther's manuscript...
1519?
Yeah. 1519. That's when Erasmus put it together. That's the one Luther...
No, which manuscripts did he use?
There were four manuscripts.
Which one? Luther.
All right, Tyndale used the 1521, which does have John 5, verse 7 in it. If that's of any...
And this is the Word of God.
I've already said to
this
you,
manuscript, that manuscript, errors here, errors there, this shouldn't be there, forgery there, and this is what you believe is the truth.
I didn't say forgery, but the truth is
in here. How do you understand the term forgery?
The truth is in here.
I disagree.
All that is necessary for salvation is in this book.
Listen, you can say it as much as you like, show me.
Show you what?
Show me why this book, which is full of error...
I can only give you the testimony of my life. Just like you can only give me the testimony.
Give the testimony
life.
In my life, yeah, the Holy Spirit could take credit for it as well.
But your life was changed. You're a different man now.
Why am I a different man?
Because God changed your life.
No, I changed my life.
Well, I believe God changed my life. I cooperated. I responded.
What teaching of Christianity do you do that you didn't do before?
I don't
change your life.
I don't drink alcohol.
You don't keep it fornication, so fornication is not allowed in Christianity?
No.
Okay. So if a Christian...
I've had one wife. I've only had one wife. I've been faithful to her.
Why one wife? Why did you say that as if like... That's...
Because Jesus taught you only to have one wife.
Really?
Yes.
How many wives did Abraham have?
Because he would have lived in a different time in the old dispensation.
Oh, I see. Okay.
But Jesus' teaching is to me is to love others, to love my enemies,
alhamdulillah,
and to do good unto others.
Alhamdulillah.
And now I can do that, whereas before I couldn't do that. It's to live a clean life. Now you might think
clean?
I don't live
I don't
a clean life because I eat pork, but I live a clean life, right? I don't indulge in fornication or pornography or all those dirty things. I'm faithful
drink
to
drink alcohol,
life, and I live a clean life.
Do you drink alcohol?
By God's help, I don't drink alcohol. No.
Yeah.
So
you gamble?
My life is clean.
Do you gamble?
Before God, I don't gamble. No.
I said this to you before. You're very close to Islam.
Well, I would say you're very close to Christianity.
No, because you don't believe what these Christians believe.
All right, you're a close follower of Jesus. You're a follower of the truth. Okay.
Yes. You're not.
I am also a follower.
I don't
of
eat
truth.
Blood. You do.
Well, you've got one on me there, because you can prove that this chicken that I may have eaten that had some blood in it.
No.
But I say to you that before God...
That's not the problem. The problem is you don't care. The problem is you don't care if it had blood in it.
There's more important things.
Well, I think the teachings of Jesus must be pretty important, and yet you don't adhere to them.
And the main teaching of Jesus was to love God with all your heart, your mind and your soul.
What did Jesus say to the rich man?
Yourself.
What did Jesus say to the rich man when he came to him? You know the score. What did he say? What do I do to need to enter the kingdom of heaven? Did he say, believe I'm going to die on the cross for your sins?
I keep the commandments.
Why didn't he say
He talked about the ten... He quoted the last six commandments.
Why didn't he, when this rich man, poor rich man, came to, this rich man came to him and said, what must I do? Pour him in salt spiritual. What do I need to do to enter the kingdom of heaven?
Yeah.
Yeah? All Jesus needed to say to them, if what you believe is true, is just believe, I'm going to die.
No, you can't bring that one on me.
Why?
Because I don't say you have to just believe. There will be some Christians who say just believe.
Oh yeah, that's
but
true.
But I don't say
true.
You should just believe. I showed you.
That's why I said you're close to Islam.
We're not to just believe. We must do the works.
What do you think the crucifixion proved? What do you think the crucifixion proved?
Jesus said on the cross. On the cross, Jesus didn't say it is finished.
Well, according
he said,
to
it is fulfilled.
Depends which gospel you read.
No, he said it is fulfilled.
Really?
And what he was referring to was when he took the
you do know
vinegar...
You do know each different gospel has a different ending.
Yes, I know that.
So what were his last words?
His last words were, it is fulfilled.
According to which gospel?
John's gospel.
And the other gospels that have a different ending?
Well, they just didn't include that one. You're changing the point.
No. The point is this. His last words are even contradictory. So you're trying to make a point of his last words, but even they're contradictory.
No, they're not, because he said there are seven sayings that Jesus said from the cross. Okay, he said it is.
And who witnessed these?
There were lots of people witnessing.
Well, the writers?
Yes.
The gospel writers?
No, there are others.
Do you believe they were disciples, the gospel writers?
One of them was.
Which one?
Matthew.
Why do you believe that?
John and Matthew.
Oh, John.
John and Matthew were both disciples.
Why do you believe Matthew was a disciple?
Because he was Levi. He was the tax collector.
Okay. Why does Matthew copy Mark?
I don't know.
The main question. See, these are questions you Christians don't even answer.
But why do I have to answer them?
I'll tell you why.
If my life has changed and I know.
Oh, just because your life. My life.
Why is that important?
So, using your example.
Is that important to God that Matthew copied Mark?
No, what's important to God?
Be honest with yourself.
I'll tell you what's important to God.
Be honest with yourself. Why is it important?
Shall I tell you? Shall I tell you?
Mark. Isn't it more important how we live?
Shall I tell you why it's important? Because you ignore God's last messenger. That's your problem. Yeah? But you're so close to it. But you just ignore God's last messenger. Because you think that's it. Now, you...
All that I need
listen
is
to me. You changing your life proves nothing. Because I've changed my life. That means Islam is the truth. According to your definition and logic. Yeah? My life's been changed, transformed.
Yeah.
Clean, healthy. Yeah, alhamdulillah. So Islam is the truth.
It could well be, but we're on a journey.
No.
We're on a journey where
you can make the claim, you see. See, you can make the claim because of your life has changed. Yeah?
But that's my only claim.
But it's not enough.
Well, it might be enough for somebody. It's not enough for you.
No. But I'm saying, because you keep holding on to this book as if what it's saying is true. And
it is true.
We've been here now maybe 40-50 minutes.
I was an atheist.
And you've still not told me why it's true.
My parents turned me away from Christianity.
I understand. You haven't told me why this is true. It should be believed. Who told you this is the word of God?
Have you read the Quran?
Because it tells me here that I can find peace. Jesus said, peace be unto you.
Alhamdulillah. Assalamu alaikum.
He said, the world cannot give you peace. He said, my peace I give unto you. And I have received that peace.
Okay. You know in Mark 7?
Shakespeare as well.
You know in Mark 7?
No, I never found peace reading Shakespeare.
You know in Mark 7? Do you believe Jesus makes all food clean in Mark 7?
Okay, that was possibly added.
Do you believe when Jesus says that all food's clean and it's not within his mind?
I don't know what God thinks about food.
When Jesus says them words,
yes.
Do you think Jesus is declaring all food clean in Mark 7 and in Matthew 19?
I've never really thought much about it.
Really?
It doesn't matter that much to me. Honestly, it doesn't matter that much to me.
So it doesn't matter when Jesus is teaching something using parables in the New Testament and you're saying it doesn't matter to you?
No, the teachings of Jesus matter to me. But whether... I don't believe that God is concerned primarily whether I eat pork or not.
No, what he's concerned is you following his teachings and his messengers, and you don't.
No, I disagree with you.
I've just proven you don't.
You're emphasizing, yes, Jesus kept the law and he encouraged people to keep the law. But he also told people to love one another.
Yeah, I know that. It's nothing to do with what we're saying.
And to love God. Now, you're emphasizing one part of his teaching. I'm emphasizing another part.
No, I'm emphasizing all of it.
I know he didn't. I agree.
So why do you disagree with him?
I don't disagree with him.
You said I would like God would be concerned if I am born.
I don't think God is concerned that I as a Gentile eat
pork. No repentance.
Because in my conscience...
Why did God say don't eat pork in the Bible, man? And don't eat blood?
Because pork is a kind of animal. It doesn't sweat. It carries the toxins in its fat.
Right. Yeah. And eel or whatever, yeah.
And they will eat any old...
Where in the Bible is pork described as food? Anywhere?
It's not.
It's never.
It's a pig is a disgusting animal.
Right. Yet you eat it. Fair enough.
I can tell you why I eat pork.
Why?
Right?
Why do you eat pork?
All right. I keep pigs to clear my land where I live.
Right.
All right? So I don't want to use chemicals on my land.
Right.
Now, it's actually worse for you to eat vegetables that have been grown in chemicals than it is to eat pork.
Right.
Because you don't know what you're eating when you buy those tomatoes off the shelf in Sainsbury's. It's halal, but it's full of chemicals. And those those chemicals are bad for your body. Now, I know what my pigs have eaten, because I mix it. This morning, before I came here, I mixed the food for my pigs, and I mixed them bread, milk, lettuce, cream, yogurt. So I know what those pigs have eaten, and also they'll eat the grass on my land. They haven't had any chemicals. They've had no injections, nothing. When we slaughter them, all the blood drains off them. So I know that that meat has not had any chemicals, it's got no toxins in it. Now, in the Old Testament, if people were not careful about their pigs, they would eat all...
So now you're rationalising, okay.
Okay, I'm rationalising.
Shall I tell you why I don't eat pork?
Okay, because you told not to. Because you told it's sinful to eat pork.
No.
And that's good.
I don't eat pork.
Yes.
Because God says, don't eat
pork. Good.
But and I don't eat blood of an animal.
Yes.
Because God says, don't eat the blood of an animal.
And that is good.
Right.
And God will
now, the difference between me and you, you pick and choose what you want to do with God. See, God tells you, don't eat the blood of an animal.
I think you're being unfair.
I'm being bang on, bro. And unfortunately, it's horrible to hear, I know. Because you have to think about this. You reflect on this, honestly.
I will do.
Because you're doing something against the teachings of God.
Okay.
And the teachers you're following to do this is Paul, right?
No, and I disagree with you there.
Okay, so Paul didn't say eat what you like in the meat market, and it was you only had the disciples of Jesus.
Then I'm not picking and choosing, because you just said I'm picking and choosing from the Bible.
Okay. So if Paul didn't write about eating what you like in the meat market, and the disciples of Jesus decreed you should eat this, you wouldn't eat that. You wouldn't. But you follow what Paul said, because you like it. You think he's a Gentile apostle. That's why.
What were you saying that I eat
you're
bacon?
Trying to basically
just like the taste of bacon.
I haven't mentioned bacon.
All right, what are you trying to say?
Okay, look, first thing, I don't know why you keep mentioning pork.
I don't know what you're trying.
I'll tell you why. You know why? Because God has never described pork as food. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we know.
So you are talking about pork.
No, I haven't mentioned pork. I told you what the disciples decreed.
Right.
Blood. Blood is the key for me, for you Christians.
Okay. Well, I try not to eat blood.
No.
So according to my conscience, I've tried to not eat.
No, and that, and this is the thing you see.
According
you know, just because you say conscience, that's what Paul says.
Yeah, and I'm a follower of Paul.
I know you are.
So what, are you surprised then?
I'm surprised you should not follow in Jesus.
No, but I do.
That's
what
I
was.
You don't. You follow Paul.
According to your understanding.
I'm sorry.
Do you know what Paul
said? You just
said
it.
No, but Paul said, follow me as much as I follow Christ. Those were his words. Follow me
Paul?
As much as I follow Christ.
Okay, I'll make it easy for you. Paul was told by the disciples to repent, make burnt offering for doing what you do.
No, I disagree.
Well,
that's your narrative of that passage in Acts 21.
Oh, sorry. Paul, we've heard you've told the people they can eat what they like. Yeah? But so they don't believe that, and to show you still keep the law, you must go with these four, shave your head, make burnt offering, and make repentance.
To show that you still keep the law.
Yes.
So, Paul...
So what was he repenting? What was the repentance he made?
He didn't mention repentance. You added that.
What was he doing?
He just took a vow, a Nazarite vow.
Okay. So what's a Nazarite vow involve?
I don't know that it does involve...
What's the purpose of a Nazarite vow?
It was consecration. My understanding, Samson became a Nazarite, he consecrated himself to God. He wasn't repenting.
He was told, look at the reason why he was told to go and do this. So that people don't think you don't follow the law.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
So
and Paul didn't follow
the
law.
So
because he was a Jew.
But he was being...
But he was trying to reach out to the
Gentiles.
Okay,
listen. Yes, exactly.
Said, you don't have to be bogged down with all these...
Yes, we know that. And the disciples said, we've decreed for the Gentiles.
Yeah, but simple things. To keep their conscience pure, they weren't...
Didn't mention conscience.
It was all about the conscience.
Didn't mention conscience.
You said that
Paul says about conscience.
Okay.
The disciples of Jesus don't mention conscience.
Yeah, but I've showed you that in Peter, who was probably...
No,
wasn't
you
by
quote...
Peter,
right, right.
But
so
one of the apostles,
what does that prove?
Apostles...
No.
It proves that one of the apostles...
It doesn't prove an apostle wrote that.
Paul, dear brother.
No, it doesn't.
Our beloved dear brother.
Does it call him an apostle?
It shows that they were united in their...
Not
teaching.
At all. The only person who calls Paul an apostle is himself.
I disagree with you.
Well, the Bible speaks for itself. You can't say Peter called him an apostle when we know Peter didn't write 2 Peter. Yeah? And these are things you have to question. Because I know you want to believe it, but it's true.
No, I accept your textual criticism, and I'm not disputing
you
on your textual criticism.
So you have to ask yourself.
I'm saying to you that I believe the whole of
you're
the scripture,
following
whoever
Balaam.
Whoever wrote Hebrews,
yeah?
Whoever wrote 2 Peter, I believe it is canonical.
You're following Balaam.
God, and I'm following it, yeah? According to my conscience.
You're not.
And I think you're being unfair to me, Hamza.
You are not following Balaam. You are. You're doing exactly what Balaam did.
I think you are
teaching. Not at all. You are following Balaam. You're doing what Paul said, to eat what you like in the meat market. The disciples made it clear. They're reflections of Jesus' teachings. You are not following Jesus. Don't think you are as a Christian. You're not.
Well, that's for Jesus to decide, not you. Thank
yes.
God. I think we should end it there.
Yeah, we shall.
Okay. That was a strong hand.
Take care, young fella.
God bless you.
We'll see you next time.